This is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Here are your hosts, Dr. Tim Slecker and Dr. Johnny Lupinacci, educated educators talking education.
Welcome to Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Educated educators talking education, the podcast. Johnny Lupinacci, what's happening, my friend?
Hey, Tim, it's great to be here. You know what, man? Changing format. Couldn't be more excited, though. This is excellent. Got Jess here, producer Jess. Listeners, we got you out there. You know, it's not the same live show it was for the last few months, Tim, but wow, what an exciting time. We've been brain trusting with the awesome people over at Civic Media, talking to all of our friends and education podcasts around the country. And Tim, I'm excited to be here with you for this homeroom drop. Yes. First homeroom, first day of class. Tim, we're back in the saddle. It's Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk. Listeners, we missed you, but we're back.
Jess, what do you think about this new format?
You know, I'm so excited for it. Gives us a little flexibility, and it means that, hey, Tim, when you go digital, we can redo it.
We can try it all over. Well, here's what I tell you what. I'm loving this. We're going to have homeroom, you know, classes in session, Friday night lights and all those things. But right away, too, Jess, what I'm excited about, too, is your voice has always in the live show been such a compelling part of Busted Pencils. Aww. And now in the podcast to bring you forward, particularly now in homerooms, you having the key with these news stories that we're going to be doing, because Monday's homeroom trending news. In fact, Jess, what do you think? Want to start dropping some trending news and see what we'll see how it sounds?
Absolutely.
All right. What do you got for us?
K-12 dive. South Carolina Supreme Court deals blow to private school scholarships. Though other services can still be covered under the state's new education savings account program, private school tuition cannot.
There we go. Wait, South Carolina, the red state,
South Carolina
actually came out and said no vouchers for private schools. So in other words, taxpayer money in South Carolina cannot be used to pay for private school. Wow. In other words, my guess is too, they said because the South Carolina Constitution very specifically says you cannot pay for private school with public monies. Johnny Lupinacci, thoughts?
Yeah, we're going to be figuring this out across the country in a lot of states, Tim. It's just a change in educational landscape and funding. So good to see that decision come out of the Supreme Court down in South Carolina. Just helping to figure out what does it mean to actually fund public schools or defund public schools, and what kinds of educational savings, incentives, and programs exist. Because I think all the way up through higher ed, we're going to see a big reform on how families can afford, right, education, quality education for their children. And so this is a big issue. Good to see South Carolina set some precedent around, you know, how can you use this kind of money? What kind of programs and incentives can states put together so families can put money away, right? Traditionally and historically for higher education, for colleges, which also fall under public and private kind of gray areas. And so, you know, it's going to be a mess for a little while. I'm actually hoping for big things from a federal level, some guidance and direction. I'm big on state rights. I like local democracy. So, you know, I like that the states are chiming in early on this. But Tim, Jess, I think we can really sit back and expect a lot of states to be going through this. And so we'll keep checking in on it. And listener, of course, we care what you think, which leads us, Tim, to a really exciting aspect as we burn through these news stories.
Right.
One of the really fun things of Busted Pencils Live Radio was all you listeners being able to call in, being able to join the conversation, being able to chime in, share your expertise, your experience, and your questions. Also, just sharing what you think Tim and Johnny ought to be talking about, especially related to these news stories. So guess what, listener? You can still give us a call at 608-557-8577. Drop us a little message in there. Leave us a voicemail. That'll go into the Busted Pencils mailbag. And Tim and Johnny and Jess will all visit that mailbag often and frequently and address those questions and issues. So, listener, whatever you're thinking about this, you know, how should public schools be funded in terms of should we allow, you know, should states allow for private school tuition to be incentivized or supported or subsidized by taxpayer dollars? I know. I don't think it should. Keep it separate, right? Private and public. Let's keep it simple. Keep it separate, and at least get our public education, you know, programs funded adequately at the state level. Tim, what do you think, though?
Well, it's on this one too. And what I appreciate with South Carolina was the absolutely saying that if you're going to use public taxpayer dollars, it cannot be used for tuition at private schools. Mm-hmm. You know, here's where it starts to come in. Is it a savings account or is it other people's taxpayer money? Because you made a good reference to saying like, hey, saving up for your kids' education, that's you saving up. Now, could there be some tax deferments on your own money? Maybe yes. The idea then that you can use that money, and this is where I think it gets gray on purpose, mm-hmm. so that we get away from this. We're still, though, talking about other people's taxpayer dollars being used for you to send your kids to private schools. And in South Carolina, no. You cannot use other people's taxpayer dollars to pay for your kids' private schooling. Are there ways to incentivize parents' ability to save for schooling of the choice of the parent and the family? I think there is room to have conversations about that. But when we're talking about public taxpayer dollars, South Carolina pulled the right strings here, which is no, taxpayer money is not available for you to send your kids to private schools. That's where I see this one.
Yeah, and it's a good question. I mean, think about it as a listener, as like a parent. Right. I'm saving money and there is a program in the state to save money for your kids to put towards your kids' education. And the details on how it can be used are changing. They're changing all the time as the educational landscape is changing. And so it's a great question because there are a lot. Historically, this has been for post-secondary education, for college. Right. And a lot of families I know around the country are asking, they're saying, hey, can I use that, though, for, you know, middle school? Can I use that for elementary school? And South Carolina said, you know, in their state, no. And I like that. Just a clear ruling on like, hey, we have these programs. They are to help invest in our young people having opportunity for higher education and educational opportunities, trainings, different vocational school programs. So I think it's an important conversation to be having, and love the news coming out of South Carolina. Give us some definitive guardrails on where taxpayer support goes into, you know, supporting our public education programs.
Jess. Yeah, move on.
Moving on to the national stage, K-12 dive. They shoot, they score. High school sports participation at an all-time high. More than 8 million high schoolers are participating in school-sponsored sports, an all-time high, according to the National Federation of State High School Associations.
Ah, sports up. Johnny Lupinacci, gotta love this too. And I love this story from K-12 Dive. If you dig deeper too, it doesn't just say sports. Everybody's out there going, oh my God, you guys are favoring all the sports. No, extracurriculars in general, the arts, the participation in the arts is up. More kids playing. What was cool though, Johnny, I like this kind of indicator here. The expansion of some of the sports, girls wrestling, has led to that increase. The idea where we're cutting across gender roles here to say, wait a minute, what can happen here? But the participation in extracurriculars, particularly sports, why is this a big deal? Because here's the thing, though. We talk about this all the time on Busted Pencils. Look, your communities, those things in life, and we'll say Friday night football, man, without your public school and Friday night football, your community is not the same place. And so to hear that not just Friday night football, but all curriculars are up in participation, that to me indicates that your communities then are going to have that much more activity to be a part of, to come together as a community, to support the play on Friday nights, to support Friday night football, to come to the girls wrestling match on Wednesday evenings. That idea there. So extracurriculars, public school, community activity, democracy, man, that's the shit.
Well, Tim, oh man, that gets in the new format listener. We get to use strategically placed exploitives.
Tim, I just reached for my sensor and realized, oh.
Yeah, it's okay. Hey, you know what, though? I like this a lot. It makes sense. It tracks. We are, you know, I know COVID is still running through our communities, but we are moving into what I'll kind of call a post-COVID era. There is a lot of return to in-person. There is a lot of activity in school and energy in in-person being at school. Part of being in a school community, part of being in community is feeling like you belong, right? And so to me, as an educator, extracurriculars were that way that it's more than just we come together to learn our math and readings, right? To learn to write better and to learn all those academic skills. Those are important. But to belong in a community, the things that you value, that you like to do are supported. And so I see a real connection here to the from this article to the increase in clubs, the increase in sports, you know, theater, choir, drama, that's theater, right? But band, quiz bowl, robotics teams, right? So all of the ways that our schools and our public school systems provide opportunities for young people to belong and to also learn from coaches and all those amazing volunteers and community who put their expertise and care into those programs. It's just awesome. It's always been a stalwart of good education systems, right? Every district can be proud of its extracurriculars and its athletics. And so it's exciting to see that it's vibrant. It's fall in the United States, across the country, football, but so many other things that go along with that, right? Just think about one Friday night on a high school or a middle school in this country. You've got football games, you've got band, you've got pep rallies, you've got, you know, all the
bonfires,
like student council. That's another one. Student leadership. You've got all these activities that are about belonging. And so what an exciting time. I mean, we are all educators in the largest social uprising of all of our lifetime. We're figuring out this post-COVID era and we're building community and making sure that all young children, however they identify, have an opportunity to belong and feel valued. And so extracurriculars are part of that. Makes me excited, Tim, because in the new format, we'll be checking in with a lot of these extracurriculars that, Tim, you always remind me, aren't extra.
Right.
You know, they're part of how we make sure our young people learn to belong, but also feel like they belong for all of the diverse ways that they share and develop their talents and their passions. So excited about that. Hey, again, I'm going to plug it. Listener, you know, give us a call, drop us a message, because what do you think about sports, extracurriculars, all these ways that we make young or offer opportunities for young people to connect and develop? 608-557-8577. Leave us a message. We'll get to your call, right? And we'll address it in our mailbag, Tim. Ripping through the news topics in this new format. You know, we're a little more condensed, but we're not constrained by commercial breaks.
Right.
Really nice. We're not constrained by those kinds of live, real-time things. Jess and Tim, man, it's the beginning of a new week. How are you both doing? Like, what's happening in your worlds?
I don't know. Jess, you jump in there first. I want to riff off of you.
You want to riff off of me? All right. I mean, well, in my world, the Dom Salvia show is now streaming on Civic Media network-wide, 4 to 6 p.m., I miss you guys live on the air, and they're keeping me busy.
I bet.
So you are busy. Yeah, we missed the live show, and I'd say that too. But again, the participation here in the podcast format. In fact, as we're talking about this here, and you know, let's talk about the new format here. So we're talking about on Mondays, a homeroom episode dropping. Wednesdays, we say classes in session, you know, where we're going to have a feature interview of some influencer newsbreaker out there with education, the way we can talk about it. So remember, you know, whether it was Jonathan Gurko. Also, too, though, on those Wednesdays, classes in session, all of those segments that we've always done, What Would Matt Damon's Mom Say?, Rethinking Schools, Wisconsin Public Education Network, Educators Amplified, always going to be a component of those Wednesday classes in session with that main feature. And then Johnny, you said, you know, coming right off of the first trending news story for the first homeroom, they shoot, they score, high school sports participation, actually all curriculars. Jimmy Koska, sports editor, Civic Media, is going to start bringing in, coming in. We're going to talk to Jimmy this Friday and make sure that he explains what's happening. But every Friday, we're going to be talking to those coaches, those players, those people out there who are absolutely making and breaking the news. I cannot wait to spend all that time. It's just so much fun. You know, class is in session, Friday Night Lights. And, you know, we've got other names for it. I think my favorite name for calling that segment, Busting Something. I'm not going to say what totally yet, but Tim, busting.
You can say, but Tim is always calling it Busting Balls. And I like that because, I mean, who doesn't like to get together with their friends and bust some balls? But I, you know, I'm thinking big, being inclusive. Not everybody likes that. I'm so right. As we're in themed with the fall, themed with the football season. I know I love football, so I'm a little biased. But first downs, Friday Night Lights, whatever we want to call it. We're getting to the extras. We're going to chop it up with you, listener. Just kind of outline what's happening in the communities around the country, especially around Wisconsin. Jimmy Kay, our first guest, right, who covers high school sports in Wisconsin and has his thumb really on all things extracurricular for the young athletes, the young, you know, talented band members, all of the really great stuff that's part of public education. So that's one of those other features, Tim. And I'm excited about these segments because they really allow for us
shorter, digestible
to get into
that
the
folks,
weeds.
You can
right?
download
can
really at the Civic Media
website or wherever you get your podcast that. Material. Tim, Jess, this is exciting. Homeroom, first day of class. It's fall. Listener, we love you. You're with us. Remember, you can give us a call, 608-557-8577. Same as always, drop your question. You know, throw us your love. Talk about what you'd like us to talk about on Busted Pencils. And Tim and Jess, man, I'm excited.
I got an idea, too, to put this out there for the listener. And Jess and Johnny, think about this. Homeroom, what do you remember about Homeroom out there, listener? What was the favorite part of Homeroom? Some of this may date some of you. That's okay, 608-557-8577. But Homeroom, man, I remember Homeroom in the 80s. Man, that was where you came in, particularly Monday Homeroom. What did we do over the weekend? Making sure, too, that the teachers did not hear because I'll tell you what. Yeah, we were doing some stuff Friday nights, Saturday nights in the 80s outside of Pittsburgh, West Homestead Woods. Hey, guess what, man? I learned to do stupid things. But we talked about that in Homeroom and all of those times, too. It was just that time to come in and reconnect with everybody before the day started to say hi to your friends, say hi to your teachers, write a couple notes, send them back and forth. Just have some fun. I loved Homeroom. So if you have your favorite Homeroom type of situation that you remember or a story from Homeroom, we want to know about that in the mailbag, 608-557-8577. Let us know about your favorite Homeroom shenanigans.
Shenanigans or whatever. I know being a Homeroom teacher, and also I can reflect back on, you know, my time in Homerooms as a student, but especially as being a Homeroom teacher, one of the things I really loved, and I'll give it a plug, you know, listener, Tim and Johnny, we're both social studies educators now. Professors of education, teacher educators. So you know, we research and we study this whole, what does public education bring to a democracy? How it's a bedrock and it's an important foundation where we learn to be together. We learn, yes, our reading, writing, and arithmetic, but we also, as we said in the show, we learn to be with one another. We learn to belong. We learn to include. We learn to be kind. We learned empathy. We learned how to build community and work together towards whether we call it the big D democracy or just having a great community. Loved Homeroom, always loved teaching Homeroom because in Homeroom, man, is where you could really build those relationships. You could kind of write the curriculum. And of course, Tim, I always plugged in lots of social studies stuff, and we're going to do that here on Busted Pencils. This is Busted Pencils, fully leaded education talk, educated educators talking education, new format. That was Homeroom number one. Listener, we plugged it a lot this show. We want to hear from you. 608-557-8577. That's a rappy cappy on Homeroom 1, Tim and Jess. Thanks for being here with us.
Love it. Thanks for busting pencils.